is you.
Hey guys.
This is you. So we got water here.
I just ran out and I drink water. Hello! In theater, they teach you to project.
Hello, back forward.
Oh, there we go.
Hello.
Never mind.
Zach. I prepared you for this. I said maybe the best way to start things is with a song.
All right.
Do you think we can get some help from everybody here in the audience?
I think they can. I think they know some of the words.
All right. We give you a cue. One, two.
If you're evil and you're on the rise, you can count on the four of us taking you down. Cause we're good and evil never beats us. We'll win the fight and then go out for pizzas. We are your slow dance. We'll always save the day. And if you think we can, we'll always find a way. That's why the people of this world believe in our show, which is great because they made some amazing content. I get like
cool pieces of fan art that I keep and take home with me that people bring. Some cookie cat pillows. I have one at home.
Like anybody like bring you an actual cookie cat sandwich?
I had one at Cartoon Network. One of our workers on the show made like a batch of it for everybody while we were watching an episode with the girl from Make-A-Wish, and then we only had half the cast though. It was a good time. Most interesting thing I've ever seen at a convention. This is a bit of an involved story, so bear with me. I'll try to tell you.
I think everyone is listening.
When I was 6 years old, I was at my friend Ben's birthday party, because he was also 6 years old, and we ate lunch. He threw up for some reason, but that has nothing to do with the story. And we then went to go watch the movie. The movie was Scooby-Doo 2 Monsters Unleashed. Good stuff, right? I loved the first one. It's one of my favorite movies.
Cinematic classic.
Yes, truly. Watched it at home all the time, right? And we went to the theater, and all the kids started to go ahead, and my dad put his hand on my shoulder, like, Zach, I'm sorry. Like, you can't see this movie, buddy. He's like, wait, what do you mean? I can't see this movie, buddy. And he's like, this movie's inappropriate. I heard there were some things in it that, you know, you're six, you're not allowed to see this. And I cried, and I screamed. So I was like, Dad, I saw the first one. I don't know what you're talking about. It's rated PG. But I never got to see it. I went home in a huff, held a grudge for, like, 7 years. And for a while, just for fun, I'd be like, hey Dad, remember when you didn't let me see that PG-rated movie because it was inappropriate? Just bring it up all the time. And that would be the end of the story. But I told the story a couple times at like panels and interviews, and I was in SAC Anime in the beginning of 2016, in January, and I was on a panel, and some nice girl came up and asked a question, and right before she left, she's like, oh yeah, by the way, I bought this copy of Scooby-Doo 2 Monsters Unleashed. Because I heard about your story and it made me sad, so here. And I still have it. And it was such a thoughtful gift, such a random item that made no sense to people. And I had to explain the context of the entire panel, but it was
it's
very heartwarming. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a real testament to how incredibly heartfelt the movie is. We only got one person with the microphone, the bravest person in the room.
Oh, that's you.
There we go.
What's your story? Much, so a lot of times I'll have her come in for an afternoon to do like 10 episodes.
Steven.
Yeah. I can't handle her voice. Our booth director, Ken Osborne, of Adventure Time fame, he does, it's not an accurate Estelle impression at all, but it's amazing. It's very cockney, like not at all her accent, and he never does it when she's around. But sometimes when she's not there, he'll read her lines for us. I'm getting off topic, but just little things like that.
This is exactly the topic, too.
He's like, Steven! He's got a very deep, masculine voice. It makes no sense, but he reads the lines.
He's like, she reads it in Australian or something.
Yes. Yeah, it's very wild. It misses the mark, but it's perfect for what it is. So, you know, those kinds of things, sometimes you do have to record solo, and you still have a good time, but it's fun when the fan is there, we're very close to the cast. Also, our guest casting. For example, whenever Zachary Steele, who was Ronaldo, was in the booth, I lose it every time. He's so hysterical, and he's a stand-up comic. That's his background. And he just, in between takes, he's bantering and like critiquing his own performance, like speaking to himself. It's hilarious. Things like that are why I like recording on something whenever we can.
Karina.
Okay, so I heard you like Panic at the Disco.
Hallelujah. She'll break it with your body, stand up, sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Look at her real quick. Who's really wrong? Biggest Tiger Millionaire fan of all time.
You're wearing the right colors too. Yeah. I was talking about Panic at the Disco earlier because I love Death of Bachelor and Brendan Urie, and I'm doing a record right now. Original songs. It's an EP that's coming out beginning of next year. It's heavily inspired by my Chem, Panic. Broadcaster shtick, things she's got going on. I love her color scheme. Just everything about certain things, but onion now. Can't do that.
When will this crazy hiatus end? Will like the new episodes come out? Like in the next month, year? Because we're desperate.
I know he's probably just as desperate.
I've been asking the network the same question. I have no idea. Truly, we're doing New York Comic Con this weekend, and I'm going to be with, I think Rebecca's coming. I'm going to ask her, like, hey, you know anything? But I don't know. even if I did know, I wouldn't be able to tell you. But I would tell you that I did. I
heard
you
were going to snipe us at all.
Blink twice or hell.
Not kidding.
I mean, besides the Scooby-Doo 2 Monsters Unleashed thing, that was really memorable. This one's, it's more of a sweet thing. I was in Miami, actually, for a convention, and this guy and his son came up to the booth, and, you know, I talked to the son for a little while, and he ended up going down the line because the rest of the cast was there, and he was talking to DB and Shelby. And the guy stayed behind, and we were chatting for a minute, and he told me something I'll never forget. He said he did two tours in Afghanistan, had major diagnosed clinical PTSD, and just felt empty inside, couldn't feel emotions, and it just ripped that away from him. And he said, you know, he was trying to spend more time with his son, and his son was really to see the universe, and he sat down and started watching it with him all the time, and he said something about like the music and the colors and the message it sends, and it brought the color back to my life. And I mean, I can't even take credit for that because it's Rebecca's vision, and just being a part of something that can impact someone like that, that's what every artist aspires to be a part of and do. So yeah, that'll always, I'll never forget that. That'll always stick out to me. Again, like, being able to, you know, give Steven a voice, it's amazing. I love my job, I love being a part of it, but I'm such a small part of the incredible amount of work that goes into the show, so I don't like to take credit for, you know, the impact it's had, just my small piece of it, maybe, but I record 3 hours for an episode, and it takes a year and a half to make it sometimes, so it's really involved.
Of the episodes, which one do you have the most emotional connections with?
A few. Space Race really hit me hard. Not while we were recording it, but later on, after rewatching it, I was like, whoa, that was like an early episode that went really heavy and went hard. And it really foreshadows Pearl's development as a character, and I love Pearl's story in relation to everything else that goes on in the show. Another one is Alone at Sea. The message, the subliminal underlying message and subtext of that episode really hit too close to home in a way, and that spoke to me on a personal level about things in my life. And there's a lot of episodes in the show that does that, as I'm sure You guys are very well aware. It hits you when you least expect it. Hello.
Hello.
I like your cosplay.
What do you think of anime?
What's that?
What do you think of anime? I mean, the whole thing. Just anime in general.
It's a good meme.
Yeah?
No, I love anime. My girlfriend's way more into anime than I am, so she's like taking me through the classics like Death Note and Cowboy Bebop and all those. But I'm currently underwatched. So I've seen Sword Art, some Full Metal Alchemist, Naruto. I appreciate it quite a bit, but I have not been able to voice a lot of it, and I have been able to watch and catch up on the classics.
Doing the homework.
Straight up, anime's dope.
What should he watch? What should he watch? What do you recommend?
What do you recommend?
Attack on Titan.
That's like near the top of my list.
Trinity Shimura is the show. She's probably going to be
on
the
Twitter scene.
I don't know any of the Hamilton songs personally.
Yeah, he hasn't listened to the album yet. He's keeping himself fresh.
I'm going in blind. Lin-Manuel, though, I do really love Moana. You're Welcome is instant classic.
Well, can I say anything? You know, there's a live band karaoke party tonight. I'm just mentioning this so that you know. I mean,
like, jokes are just general.
No, it's like in my band, I'm singing Fat Bottom Girls, so you can't do that.
That's a good karaoke song.
Yeah, so, I mean, if you want to come hang out at the official after party, you know, maybe.
Text me.
Yeah, we'll.
I have a dinner plan with some of the homies, but
we can
go
later.
On later. I may let me roll through.
All right.
I do love some karaoke. I can't.
Yeah, it'll be a great party whether Mr. Superstar shows up or not, but he's going to show up because we're going to be
anybody else has been to some of the other Florida cons that I've been to and have seen the karaoke there, you've probably seen my dad performing. He's not with me at this convention, but he is karaoke. He does like 3 songs a night wherever there's karaoke. He just loves it. And I'm
serious. He really is all about it.
Yeah. You haven't met him because he wasn't in Boston.
I saw him very briefly at that one Texas show, but nobody cares about this.
Yeah. He's like if I were born in like the late 50s. Like that's basically what we look a lot alike. I get my performer gene from him. He loves that performance. I'm getting way off topic. You had a second question.
What are your thoughts on Watermelon Steven?
What was that?
Your thoughts on Watermelon Steven?
On Watermelon Steven? I think it's hilarious and also sometimes tragic. I get to voice all watermelons, including the dog and like the little baby watermelon and all of them. I don't even remember what the voice is for that. They have to pull it up for me every time. Really, this is what you sounded like. Sound like this again. But all of them, like, I usually just loop a bunch of like background wall art for the whole like, village of them. It's a good time. Any like I end up playing a lot of food related characters on the show. Onion, all the watermelons, a crying breakfast friend, pumpkin. I do pumpkin. So like anything food related, I'm just like yeah, give us a sack. I need to do something. Good question. Steven the Steven was a logistical challenge because I had to talk to myself 4 hours straight. I was in the booth alone. I was basically doing like 4 characters worth of dialogue in an episode in a 4-hour session. So we like went to the max, like used all of our time short of our breaks to get that one done. And I had to layer all my vocals on the song 4 times, which was interesting. From an emotional perspective, Bismuth was a really tough one just off the top of my head. The final scene from that one it's like, really, he feels so betrayed, but he doesn't want to give up on her, and he's like fighting her, but he's like trying not to hurt her at the same time. It's really, once I got the script for that, I was very excited. It's very well written. And that was also like our 100th episode, I think. It was getting real, I'll put it that way.
Had you always wanted to be a voice actor?
What's that?
Had you always wanted to be a voice actor?
How did I know I wanted to be a voice actor? Oh, I didn't intend to. I moved to Los Angeles after acting in theater and stuff in St. Louis to do film and television, like on camera, and I still do. But voiceover just sort of found me. I booked a radio show called Adventures in Odyssey, if anyone's ever heard of it. There's usually like 2 people at every panel. It's a totally different like fandom than conventions, but I worked on that for 5 years and learned all the ropes. Met Jim Cummings and Jess Arnell and all these really awesome voice actors who gave me tips and stuff. Sophia the First came along after a while. I did that for a couple of years, and then somewhere in there I missed Steven, and that was 5 years ago.
Thanks.
Do you like memes that your fans make?
Too wide, like memes. Memes are my purpose of existence, really. real talking. And I love the Steven memes that the fandom makes. They crack me up. And does anybody know what deep fried memes are?
Yeah.
Just a few people. They're basically when you like turn the saturation knob up a ton, distort everything, make it nearly impossible to read. They call that deep fried. I love deep fried memes. And I was browsing through the nuked memes subreddit, which is just like memes that have been deep fried to 11. It's like abstract art of the meme world. There's no joke. The joke is that they, like, it's just a bunch of like static on an image. And I saw one and it was like, I could barely make out. I was like, wait a minute, is that Jasper? It's randomly on this page, having nothing to do with Steven Universe, and the title was like in Chinese or something. And it was just Jasper, like, distorted and like all the wrong colors. It was weird. So, seeing things like that pop up, and like seeing, you know, some of the memes that are closer to Earth that the fandom makes are really fun. I love the first time I saw somebody bring Dee Dee a salt packet at a convention. And she didn't know why. She didn't understand salty pearls. She's like, thank you. She like looked at me like didn't know how to process that. If anybody's seen the panel on YouTube, the Pearl Secret Rap Career panel from MomoCon earlier this year with me, her, and Mackenzie Adam, we basically sat Dee Dee down in a large panel room about two or three times the size of this, completely full. And everybody, it's an anime convention, so everybody's in on the joke. Everybody knows all the memes except for her. So me and Mackenzie, like, she crafted this amazing slideshow curriculum of mimology and mimetic theory and explained it in context of, like, here's an example of a meme, and here's a meme in Steven Universe form. So, like, Shooting Star, for example, she showed her a normal video, like, da, 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 and then she showed the Steven one that she actually made and put on YouTube. And over the course of the hour, like, she went from being baffled as to why we're all laughing at the same thing to laughing with us and understanding how they worked. That was my favorite, like, fandom theme-related memory. It's my favorite panel I've ever done. It was amazing.
Do you think we will ever get a Paradox Fusion?
I hope so. I've been campaigning for Steven Paradox for, like, years now. And I've been, like, pitching my idea, like, well, what if she was shorter instead of taller, and we had like a gray matter, like Ben 10 style, like little guy on the team, and this is why I don't write the show. But I really want it to happen, so we're in the same boat.
We can keep hoping for Steven.
Steven Dot, get that hashtag out there.
Is the gray and lovable Paradot truly the leader of the crystal quads? You're a quad.
Come on! I'm gonna keep going before we go to see the secret system now, because I think we'll go all day.
I think I can follow up to that. Oh my gosh. What's your favorite behind the scenes moment with any of the voice actors of Steven Universe, like, you know, Estelle or Dee Dee?
Oh man.
Prank each other? Do you give each other crap?
We're pretty good to each other. I've been involved in some pranks with some like other voice actors at conventions before. That's been fun, but. All good fun. But for the Steven cast, behind the scenes moment. There's just been so many, like, we go to these conventions together, we like go out and see stuff, go to dinner, like have all these little in jokes from the studio. Here's one that I really love from the studio. It's our engineer Robert Serta, for the longest time at the Cartoon Network. He keeps like a folder of like things that he catches on the mics, like image takes that he really likes, and he keeps them for his own personal use. And like one of them was, he basically keeps them so that he can loop them and like replay them during the session as a joke. So Dee Dee was doing some fighting noises, and she, like in between noises, she made the weirdest sound I'd ever heard in my life. And it was hysterical. It was like, ha, ha, so. And we thought it was hilarious at the moment, and then he like pressed the button a couple times and over the speakers, and we're all having a laugh. We move on, we do a couple more lines. There's a lull, they're like, doing some notes in the booth. All of a sudden, tuck, tuck, tuck. And it just keeps going and going, like the whole rest of the session, like just won't let her let it down. I think a couple sessions, like in the weeks after that, it came up a couple times too. Just, we also have to think the earthquake noises and like lunar ceasefire way early on, one of the first episodes we recorded. We had to do, it was like labeled in the script as earthquake noises. And we're like, how do we, like, what is this? So we're all like figuring out our own, like, whoa! We were like just getting into the characters at that point. It was super new, and that was like a great icebreaker for us. Was trying to figure out like what do earthquake noises mean. Anytime like these weird notes, like earthquake noises or short gasps is one that happened all the time. Like, oh man, I got like short gasps. What do I do with this short gasp? Same as all the other short gasps. And stupid stuff like that is what keeps it like. Because voiceover, you know, you're doing the same line three times in a row, three different ways, and you're like making all these weird noises. It's
speaking of that, some of the very important things
happen.
Thank you. This is probably really late, but can you sing the Cookie Cat song?
The Cookie Cat song. Can I get some help from the people?
Oh, he's a frozen treat with an all-new taste, because he came to this planet from outer space. A refugee of an interstellar war, but now he's at your local grocery store.
Cookie Cat!
He's a pet for your tummy.
Steven Seeker rap career where he gets jealous, and I wrote a rap and performed it and recorded it, and Mackenzie edited Steven Universe, which is going to be great. I'm super excited.
And your mom. Literally, your mom.
I know we're not supposed to exist together, but
I'm
the universe just
saving
my son.
You sound like Susan Egan. That tripped me up for a second.
Okay, but to the question. As Steven, we've seen him fused with Connie first, then with Amethyst, so he can also be fused with both. As Steven, who do you think he either should or could fuse with again? Or new gem?
Paradot, 100%. I'm going hard in the paint in this campaign. Steven out, guys. Get tweet.
Steven.
Steven Dot, Steven Dot. Steven Dot, Steven Bob. Let's make it known. Make your voices heard.
Hi, I have two questions. First, have you played
Mass Effect Andromeda? I've been meaning to get to it. I feel like I'm going to enjoy it just because I love the series so much. I haven't had a lot of time for games as of late. And I've been replaying the trilogy with my girl because she hasn't played it before. So.
You're introducing her to Mass Effect, she's introducing me to anime, this is so romantic.
It's wonderful. It's there though, it's great.
It's great.
And then, who's your favorite Mass Effect character?
Oh man.
Can I put a twist on that?
Yeah.
Femme chef or male chef?
Por que no los dos?
Por que no los dos?
If you're a real fan, you can play Gears of Both.
There we go.
Can't miss it. There's little quirks that happen. They both have the same dialogue, but like at certain points in the trilogy, there will be like a wildly different take. I played through Femme Chef in Mass Effect 1, theorem when you're like escaping the mine. Femme Chef says a line like, Joker, pull the Normandy around, on the double. But it's like pretty normal. And then Mark Meer's version of it on Male Chef when I played through, it's like he does like a completely different voice. Joker, pull the Normandy around for Pika, on the double, mister! I was like, where did that come from? It's back to completely normal afterwards. This is why I can't just play one. I have to do both.
So getting that choice out of the way, do you have another Mass Effect character that you really, really love?
Tali Zorro's great. Just because he's here, he's like, it's so brilliant, is Morden Solus. I mean, it's such a well-written character. Bill put in one of the best
you.
What?
Hey! Wow, again.
Have you ever considered cosplaying any of the Steven Universe characters?
I've thought about it. I wouldn't cosplay Steven, because I feel like, I don't know, I feel like there's a disconnect. Like, I'm not Steven, Steven lives here. I feel like it would be weird.
It'd be like when Steve Carell dressed up as Groot, you'd have to put some prosthetics on.
Right. Yeah, I don't know. I feel like I'd be uncomfortable with cosplay Steven. If I was going to do it, I would probably do, like, Ronaldo or something. One, body paint is hard. And two, like, just running around yelling, keep it sitting weird, would be, like, just me. Yeah, I used to do really cool Halloween costumes that my mom liked to sew. So I did like Journey, the game Journey. I did Tacticus from that. Lone Wanderer from Fallout, Link 1 year, lots of cool stuff. And I really like doing that for Halloween, but I've never done it at a convention because usually I'm here working.
So is your mom still around to help me costume? Because I spent 2 weeks on this whole costume.
It's gorgeous.
Yeah, it looks really great.
Cosplay repair. Cosplay is a war.
Yeah, it's the constant war against your own clothing.
The week fell out of shape and I spent 2 hours. It's my best friend's birthday and he had to wear this wig
for me,
so I
can
get
off
the
toilet. That's a good
friend. Yes.
Where is your friend now?
They're in the morning.
Mad respect to you.
This is why we come to conventions, right?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bye, Mom.
And can you do any accents and impressions, and if so, can you perform?
I'm doing some later, and Twist the Tunes.
Yeah.
Who watches South Park?
Yeah. Woo! No, kitty, this is Matt Packpack! No, kitty, no!
I'm doing a couple of those too. I'm doing that. Does anybody play Modern Warfare Call of Duty? Remember Scatman Price?
Yes.
Seven, this reach is perfect. Targets, left side, left side! I don't like
it. Mission
failed, get
him next time. And I should mention, if you're interested in this live All-Star voice actors, feel free to the Princess Bride. It's going to be right here in Ballroom 8 at 4:30 p.m. today.
Yes. It's going to be a good time. It's my debut on Twisted Tune. I'm going to travel to all the conventions.
Yeah.
It's going to be a good time. Lars and Cindy. Totally. I mean, it's pretty much like there already, but I fully endorse it.
Another thing, do you read Ronaldo's website?
Like, I did not. I think that was fan created, or maybe it was somebody from the creator. I don't remember. It's on the blog, right? The Keeping City Group. Yeah, I flipped when I saw that. It's super funny.
Hi.
Hey again.
What's your opinion on Labanon?
On Labanon? My public opinion or my actual opinion?
Let's keep it in the room and on social media, whatever he says.
Where are the cameras? Where are the snipers? I love their relationship as it is on the show now. I don't know where it's going, but I love their dynamic and I love that they made them like reluctant roommates. And I love that the fan base like takes, you know, ships and, you know, fan headcanons and just run with them. I used to do it all the time. I wrote like adventure fan fiction of Toph Beifong from Avatar The Last Airbender. that's what inspired me to like start writing. So I fully support, you know, people doing that kind of stuff.
One more question: what do you think of Ruby and Sapphire?
Adorable. Adorable. They're amazing. Jailbreak is one of my favorites.
Thank you. You're amazing.
No, you're amazing. Yeah, you're wearing a 21 Pilots hat.
Now, even though we're running short on time, I think we can get through everybody's microphone rapid fire. You guys think we can do it?
Yes.
Yes.
Can we? Are we
going to
see like another crossover with like Finn?
I don't know. Adventure Time.
they're going the last half of the last season.
The final season, yeah. I love the Uncle Grandpa War. It was just so goofy, and we knew it wasn't canon, and we got to have a good time with it. I'd love to do more. I've always said Steven Universe and Pokemon would be amazing, but it's totally not going to happen ever. But I can dream pie in the sky. That would be like psychopathic, really. Let's do an episode of Steven Universe where Steven and Onion have to bond and fuse to fix a problem and just end up stealing a bunch of stuff. I really want that. I am not. I know it's very popular with the fandom, and I believe the Stronger Than You Undertale parody has more views than the actual Stronger Than You on YouTube.
It makes no sense!
It's very popular. I think it's cool. I just haven't gotten around to it. Some of my friends are really into it. I see. Yeah, that's an Undertale cosplay, right? I'm Ashley. I'm Ashley McKay.
Hello.
Hello.
In your honest opinion, and just for you in general, what show on the air right now, would you like
Steven
or
Cross?
Sorry,
Cross over the Sure. Mm. I think that would be fall. Of like other Cartoon Network shows, OKKO, I mean, our shows are already dating, because it's Ian Jones Forty's show, and there's like little references to Steven in there. We have references to OKKO, like I think they had OKKO playing on Steven's TV once. And Ben and Matt's show that they're working on, they moved on from writing for our show to doing their own, and I got to audition for the pilot and seeing the specs and stuff. It's really, really cool, and I think it would be a cool crossover, but I don't know that I'm going to
what's your opinion on the song Peace and Love on the Planet?
It's beautiful. We, you know, Paradot got to have a moment in the sun. I wanted to sing along. Hello. When's the what?
When's it coming back on here?
Yes. I wish I knew.
We're trying to, like,
trying to come back. You will know. Follow Rebecca, follow Cartoon Network, some of the cast on social media. You'll know.
Yeah, next weekend being New York Comic Con, hopefully you'll hear something.
Yeah, we're all going to be there. I don't know what we're doing, but
they're already dressed in Wednesday Adams.
It's great.
It's making me very nervous.
She's amazing.
You're amazing.
It's just a simple concept, but a sapphire that's just a little bit off and can predict the past.
The Internet Explorer of the Gems.
Wow, that's really good. Who's Chrome?
Garnet.
Yeah. It's now all the best features of all the other browsers fused together. What was the second question?
What are your thoughts on Mayor Dewey?
On, I didn't hear the last part.
Mayor Dewey.
Mayor Dewey. Mayor Dewey is... He tries. He's, you know, I think he's really going to enjoy retirement and not worrying so much about his own image. Mayor Dewey, Mayor Dewey. I have no appreciation. I've never been able to report which I'll watch it before, but I started watching the new MST3K and like understanding what that show is, and it's amazing, and I have a newfound appreciation for him outside of Steve. My favorite human though is definitely Rama. Keep me city weird! Money is not human. Don't go there with me. Hello there. To become a voice actor, what was that about school?
Like, what school? Did you go to any schools or anything?
You know, I took lessons outside of school, but for me, I was homeschooled until high school, fourth grade to high school, and then I did, like, independent study charter programs, which are, you go in once a week to turn in more, do the rest at home, so that I can, you know, be on sets and take acting classes. I've been studying music, acting, voice acting, piano, all sorts of different classes since the time that I was 7 years old, and that's been my version of school, I guess, because, you know, my actual school is always like, you know, get it done, move on to, like, the thing that I'm doing, actually doing. It was a strange way to grow up, in a good way. Like, I really enjoyed it. It's all about training, like, and you can train without classes, too, if you want to get in the business. I want to be a voice actor.com, D. Bradley Baker, legendary voice actor extraordinaire, and also Lion at Steve University. He made a website for people who wanted to get into the business of voice acting, because there's really not a lot of resources. It's pretty small, and there's no obvious way in, and most people don't set out to become a voice actor in the beginning. They're another kind of actor, they're a performer, and it just kind of happens by accident. So being well-rounded and training in music, or theater, or film, that only do as well.
Before we fully wrap things up, a couple of orders of business. In this room, 3 o'clock, Charlotte Chung from Overwatch.
Yeah.
If you are familiar with her, yes. All right, so definitely come back in for that. You got your Twisted Tunes, Princess Bride reading 4:30.
Yes, we do.
In this room. You're going to be here the rest of the weekend. I'm going to finish by asking, of the other guests that are here at the show, you know, you've had your fanboy moments like Jen Hale and other shows. And this one in particular, is it somebody you run into in the green room, or that you're going, oh man, what happens when I run into this person, you know, in passing?
I mean, Bill Sowers, I mean, we're like friends, and we were doing last night, and, you know, it doesn't make me nervous or anything, but I forgot that he was Morden until I saw the print on his table today, and I remember it again. I was like, oh man. I started nerding out, and I talked to him a little bit about it, and about the project, and just how much I appreciate the performance. It's cool to be able to talk to, you know, people who do things love on the same level, like I said, here, doing the same job. That's why I'm not huge on, like, stopping celebrities from walking down the street. Like, I'm totally cool, like, if somebody does it to me, but for me, I want to meet them, like, in a work situation. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And this is
a pro, dude. You're a total pro, bro.
Pro, bro?
Yeah.
Wrong.
Dude, you're, like, so professional.
I'm super professional. Thank you, bro.
You're welcome. Do I hate you? Dude, what do I hate you, bro?
Bro, I stopped the sneeches.
What?
It is the devil's most fire baked juice you've ever baked. Really? Your baking career, bro.
Dude, I did not know that there was a juice out there. I did not know. You've got to introduce me to this, bro.
Bro.
You got to hook it, bro, up.
Bro, it's called Hell Pineapple Twist.
Shut up, dude.
They make it in the Bay Area?
Bro, no way.
Dude. Bro. Dog.
Yeah. And you see
it. I do this with somebody or to myself every day. Like, the California has ruined me.
So, he's here the rest of the weekend. Go up and see him. He takes his time with everybody, which many of you here in the room already know. No. Let's hear it one more time for Zach Allison, everybody.
I think I'm going to be a little bit. Hope to see some of you there. This is returning faces from earlier. You guys are lovely. Thank you.